Okay, hello everyone. Welcome to our Tech Talk. We are starting right now. So I will be starting with just a very brief introduction. Then I'll handle the talking to Kay, which is joining us for this Tech Talk. And at the end of the session, we will open for a few minutes to take questions from the audience. If you have any doubts, questions for any of us, you can either write them down or you can anticipate them on the chat box or the Q&A box of the Zoom platform, and we will address those questions at the end of the talk, all right? Okay, so the title of our of today's talk is Serverless Debugging with VS Code and AWS SAM. Just a little bit about ourselves. So Kay, which is already connected, listening to us, he's a developer advocate, developer relations specialist, sorry. He has more than 12 years of experience working with serverless, and he's also specialized in mobile interfaces. And apart from that, he's also a writer and a developer relations consultant. My name is Renato. I'm a developer advocate at Dashboard. I have experience building serverless backend systems for various large scale services from data mining to machine learning, for example. We are connected to the two supporters of today's Tech Talk. So the first one is Dashboard. It's a serverless monitoring and debugging platform. It is designed especially for serverless backends. So it provides algorithms for automated fault detection. It allows to set up custom performance policies and receive alerts in real time by email or Slack whenever things go south in your backend. It also integrates with X-Ray for tracing your applications, and it has a ton more features. So head to dashboard.io after this talk and register for the account. We are also available at Twitter at the dashboard handle. And also Moisif is an API instrumentation and analytics platform. So it provides out-of-the-box analytics for web APIs. So it tracks API and user behavior and also comes bundled with a smart alerting system. It is compatible with all modern API standards flavors. So whatever is your flavor, whether it's REST, GraphQL, or anything else, Moisif is your API partner. You can find them on moisif.com and Moisif HQ handle on Twitter. So after the talk, please head to Dashboard and Moisif websites or Twitter accounts, and please thank them for supporting this tech talk. For today's talk, we will be covering how to debug serverless applications locally with Visual Studio Code and AWS SAM. How to automate Visual Studio for one-click debugging, and how to instrumentate your debugger from within your own code. We also have a repository. It's on github.com/k-is/debug-lambda-vs-code. So everything we are going to present here today will be available at these inside this repo as well. So go ahead and bookmark it, or if you need, we're going to send this presentation by email along with the recording later as well, so you can check this URL later. All right, so I will head to Kay now. So Kay, if you turn on your mic, share your screen, please.
And Hello, everyone. Welcome to this webinar. I'm Kay, and I'm going to show you about debugging with Visual Studio Code and AWS SAM CLI. What we will do is we will start with a simple basic SAM CLI project, and then introduce an error and try to debug it. And later I will show you how to set up Visual Studio Code so the debugging gets easier and you don't have to run five things before everything gets running. I created this this repository that covers most of the stuff we are doing here. Has some useful links at the bottom. The original article I wrote for Moisif with the if you like to read about it. So what we need, what I already have installed is Docker, because the AWS SAM CLI will run you AWS Lambda function inside a Docker container on your system. It will use the AWS CLI in the background, and of course you need an AWS account and Visual Studio Code. These are the things I have already installed, and I will start from basic SAM init, so we get a project, SAM project with the Hello World function, and that is written for the Node.js version 10 runtime. So, the SAM init command just creates a project with the Hello World function, and it will does this with a, like I said, with a JavaScript runtime. And it already tells us that we can use this command to invoke the function locally. So if everything worked correctly, this command should give us some output and not error. So I'm going into the project I created, and I'm using this command that it suggested me, which, by the way, won't work out of the box because they forgot to update their documentation. They say I can use the event, the example event in the root folder of my project, but they pushed all the events inside the events folder. So if I run this, I will get an error, but I will do this just for show you. So I got this error because the event isn't in the root folder. It's actually in an events folder. Yeah, so this tries to run the function locally inside a Docker container. It uses a specifically created Docker image created by AWS for this. Shows how long everything run and how much memory it used and everything, and the output of this, of everything here. So everything is set up and worked, and we can run code locally. So now I will start Visual Studio Code in this folder. So we can see get some errors here. So save. So it had a previous version in the cache from my last test of this talk. So it has created this project for us, the SAM project, and we can run it. So now the next step would be to introduce some kind of error inside our function. Here we have the Hello World function inside the app.js. And one kind of error that always happens, or that often happens, is people are sending you wrong events from your API gateway or something. Yes, so this event is the event we got from here. It's rather big, but can understand here's the path parameters or the query string parameters, stuff we know from our HTTP APIs. And now here we get a query string parameter called foo that has the value bar. And let's say we would like to use this parameter in some kind of way. So we could do anything with our API. We get some stuff from our clients, and we want to use it in our API. So, and we get this by extracting it from our event. It was called foo, I think. Event, and it's inside our query string parameters. So, and now we can use the foo parameter in some kind of way, like here, for example. Use message, use hello plus foo. And we would save this. And now the content of this foo parameter, the bar, should be added to the hello string that is our message we get back. Let's use the terminal for this and run the command like we did before. We use the sam local invoke hello world function. This is defined in the template YAML, the sam template. It's called the hello world function, and we use inside the hello world folder the file app.js. And we use a function in export called lambda handler. Yeah, so hello world, app, app, lambda handler, export. So we use this, and it's accessible for the SAM local invoke via the resource ID we selected here, we created here, or that was created for us. Just that you know how everything is interconnected here. And then I will run this, start the Docker container and do its thing. And as we can see, we get the body and its message, hello world bar. So everything makes sense here. But now it could be that for whatever reason, someone forgot or mistyped this here, and when it sent it to us and got a typo, and now the foo doesn't exist anymore. And when we run this, the output isn't as we liked. Yeah? Classic JavaScript, no warnings, no anything, just did this thing, and now we used something like Dashbird or Mossif to find out about this error, and now we have to debug it locally in some kind of way. So to do this, Visual Studio Code comes with an integrated debugger, a UI, that can be connected to a Node.js running process that has that runs a debug server. For this, we have to create a debugging configuration. It's called launch.json. And this will have many configurations that will show up here at the top, where we can use launch program. Yeah, its name is launch program. So if we change this, this will change. If we add more of them here, we will get more here. Like we have like two, like program two, then we will have this here. So you can see this is the launch.json. It's inside the .Visual Studio Code, a folder of our root from our project. It's created by Visual Studio Code. To get this, the basics running, this is like you start your process. It will wait for you for a debugger to connect, and then you will start your debugger and it will connect to your process. We need to follow in configuration. I won't type it everything by hand right now, but I will go over it after I copied it. So as you can see, when I go in here, it's attached to SAM CLI. So what does this do? First, it has a name. Yeah, this is what shows up here. Then it has type node for Node.js. Request attach. This means that it just it doesn't have to start any external process or something. It just tries to connect to some already running process. And this process runs on localhost and port 9999. So when I start this, it will connect to this SAM to the SEM process that runs in Docker and tries to get some debug informations out of it. The other things here is the local root. So think debugging works when we set our breakpoints here. Yeah. So it needs some way to map the data from inside the Docker container to our file system here. And this is the local root, is the file dir name. Yeah, it's the dir name of this file we have opened here. And also the remote dir name. Yeah, and we get this here in the output somewhere. Here mounting blah 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 s var task. Yeah, so this is the mounting point. So what we get here is this, yeah, from dir file dir name, and what we need to add manually is the var task folder inside the Docker container. The protocol is inspector. This is the debug protocol, and we won't stop on entry. We can set this to true for debugging purposes. Yes. So what will happen? We now need some kind of process that listens on port 9999. If we start our SEM local, it will just run and do its thing and be done with it and not wait for us. For that, we need to add another command line argument called D for debug and a port on which the process will listen. This will cause SEM CLI to start the process with a debugger server, and it will just wait for our connection. So it runs and then it says debugger listening and port etc. Everything runs and it doesn't execute the function now because now we have to go into open our file because our launch.json uses file dir name, and this is the file with the current focus, yeah, which we opened here. So if I use launch and I press debug, then it will use the launch JSON as a dir name, which wouldn't work. So we need to have the file open we want to use. So we can set a breakpoint here, and then I would debug. And it started at the very beginning. Yeah, you can see this is some internal file things that doesn't give us much information. That's why I am removing stop on entry. I set this on false so we don't end up in this file, but at least it stopped and we can see the terminal debugger attached, everything is connected, and the debugger console works, and we waited on the first line. So now when we set continue, it goes to the first breakpoint we have, and we can now see in the side panel here in the sidebar the variables we have, like event and foo. Foo is undefined. Yeah, we already knew foo is undefined. So let's look inside our event. What is going on here? We used our query string parameter. Query string parameter is this here. So, oh yeah, now we can see foo is written wrong. So now we could write some kind of code to fix this problem, add some checker for this, or send back to the client that he didn't use the right query string parameter. So this is the basics of everything here. Yeah, we could also add some watch expressions here, event query string parameters. So we wouldn't have to go in here in every detail in this big object we get here, but we would directly see, when we start this process that, so we could start it, like now I forgot to add the breakpoint, could add a breakpoint and start everything here, and terminal would run and We have to start manually. That's the problem. You can see it. You can see the problem here. We have already to go into the terminal and start our process manually, which is like you're sitting here and you're clicking, and nothing happens. And you're like, what is wrong? What is going on here? And you have to go to the terminal. You have to type the sem invoke command and everything, and then it would run. And then we would go here, and now we can see, it's directly here to see nothing. We wouldn't have to dig into the object. We see it directly here. So these are the basics. It's you start in the terminal, your stuff, you connect your debugger, and everything works. So, and the next step would be to improve the launch.json, so it would do everything for us, so we wouldn't have to go into the terminal anymore. Yeah. I would look into the chat right now if there are some questions. No, okay, just everything works. People are happy, I think. I hope you're happy.
Does anyone have any questions so far about what Kay has already covered? He's about to move to a second part of the talk. Right. So we showed our email addresses and Twitter accounts as well. So if you want to reach out to us later after the tech talk, feel free as well. So Kay, please go on.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Everything this is done. We are finished here. And so now, as I said, we have everything up and running here. The next step would be the Visual Studio Code integrated debug. As you can see, the config is much more complicated. Well, it isn't that much more complicated because most of these are arguments, but let's do this. As you can see, we can add another configuration. We don't have to override the previous one if we want to use it for any reason. So what did I add here? Debug with event.json. What do I do here? This time I don't inspect. I launch. What do I launch? A runtime executable, which is called SAM, because SAM is installed globally, so I can just use SAM like I did in the command line. And I supply it with some runtime arguments. These are basically the arguments I'm using here. SAM local invoke D minus D for the debugger, minus T for the template.yaml. It will use the template.yaml from the current working directory, but you can supply it with a fixed one. So it will always use this YAML file for you, which is this here. As you can see, I'm already using variables. These are supplied by Visual Studio Code, and I already used it here. The workspace root is always the same for this workspace. So it will use the workspace and then slash template.yaml, and that is this file. Then it will use the event.json from workspace root events slash event.json. Yeah, this is the file we had here. This event file we use for example purposes. And then the selected text. Yeah. I use selected text here because it allows me to pass any text I select into this launch configuration. Yeah. What you can see here is that we have many indirections here. We have the template.yaml that uses the hello world.function to locate functions. Yeah, and you have in this configuration, you have to say it's in this folder, it uses that file, and that file exports that handler. But you don't use hello world slash app.js colon lambda handler or something to get to this file. You only use here, as you can see, you only use hello world.function. You only use this reference here. So one way to get around this is to simply force everybody to call their handler the same as the hello world function resource ID at the top, which is a bit restrictive. So I had the idea to simply use this string as it is here and add it as a comment at the top of my function handler. Like so, and now I can select it when I run this debug with event.json. Yeah. To go back here, it says selected texts should be added as last command line argument to the SAM call. So it uses the events from the event.json from the events folder, it uses the template.yaml, and it uses the function name I'm giving it via selected text, and I selected hello world.function here. So so this will get passed to the as an argument. So when I save this and run this, it finished because, well, it didn't stop at entry. Yeah. So let's do this and again.
You probably want to add a breaking point on the code as well.
Yeah, sure. We can add a breakpoint here and then run this like this. So now we are going to, as you can see, I didn't have to run anything in the command line. Getting some of the command debug console outputs in the debug console, and now I can simply go into a file, select this comment at the top, and it will pass everything to the SAM CLI, and we can debug it from there. Like you can see it, I think the debug console also shows the command I passed. You can see here I used here hello world function. This is what I when I use this this code part here and would run the debugger again, it will pass lambda handler, as you can see here, and it doesn't find a lambda handler because the template didn't define any lambda handler function. It tells you this is what is defined for functions, so you can use these functions, but you can't use this string here. As I said, you can do different things with that. I use the selected text, yeah, which requires me to write a comment at the top, yeah. But you could also force everyone to do it like this, like saying they have to call this the same way as their resource thing here in their template file. Yeah, it doesn't have to be called lambda handler, it has to be called hello world function, the same as this here. And then you wouldn't have to write a comment, then you could run this directly here. You can see hello world function works and invoking hello world, and it stops there. And well, because I didn't have a breakpoint, it didn't go inside that function, but it still works. Yeah. I think this is a matter of taste. I did it with comments. You could also use file names. This is where we go to the next point that is important. You can see all these variable substitutions I used here. Yes, file dir name and workspace root and selected text. And this is defined in Microsoft gives you these variables in Visual Studio Code, and you can use this site here to find every one that is available to you. So you can use this whole bunch of variables to define your own mechanism, how you pass the function name into the debugger, so it knows the, or into the SAM CLI, so it knows which function you have to run. You could use a file name, you could use a handler name, you could use a directory name or whatever. No? I used selected text because, yeah, it requires me to select text before I have to run it, but yeah, that would be a way to do it. Another way would be you don't use selected text here. You explicitly write here your function name, yeah, and then it would only work for this function and this event. Yeah, you can write configuration for every function and every event permutation, but yeah, it's the question of taste, I think. If you like it like that, you can write like 100 configurations here, or you can write one that requires you to do some work to get it running. What the next point that is that I found interesting is that you don't need only the function name, but also the event name. So while this is rather flexible, it can be used for different functions. It works only for the hard-coded event name in this place. You can imagine that this is already a bit problematic because if you have like 10 different functions, you probably don't want to run them with the same event. Often you have like 10 events for testing purposes. You have a broken event, you have a working event, you have an event with that content, with that content, everything you want to test. And so you would also still have to write event for every event, such a configuration here, which could get quite cumbersome. And this is where I would go to the next step. An idea that I had about debugging, which would incorporate some kind of script and make the whole thing much more flexible. So the idea is, I had this repository here and we did this, we did that, and now we're going into this. As you can see, it's a bit easier because most of the stuff that we had configured inside this we had to write inside this configuration, we can now write inside the script that I will write later. It will debug with script, yeah, that's the name. It will run, it launch an executable in the workspace called debug.sh. We don't have this at the moment, so I have to create this. So the debug.sh will have this content. The basic idea is it's a small script. If you don't count these new line thingies here, basically three lines of bash code. What it does, it takes the first argument it gets and splits it into an array, and then it passes the first array parameter, the first array piece to the SAM local invoke function as function name, and the second one as event name. Yeah. And what the launch .json does is it will launch this script. It will use the selected text as its only argument, and then all the, start this thing, yeah, and as you can see, the only argument here will be split, and the second part will be used as event, and the first part will be used as function name. And you can see the other arguments for the SAM command are encoded in this debug sh. So we don't need all this stuff here anymore. We just need our selected text. So and how does this work? It will work as I did with my example before. We can write a comment and define, as you can see, the file, define with function name and event name. Yeah. So function name is hello world that function, and the event name is called like this. We could also have a new file, event broken JSON, for our debug purposes, like we'd use this and event broken. And so we have here a working event, and here we have our broken event, and we could use event and event.broken. This is why I used comments before, because of the script thing. It would be a bit tricky to mark this and then mark this. Yeah, I know it works. It's just a bit higher level editor handling. Yeah, and now you just had to mark this. This would be used in the launch to get passed it here into the debug sh, and the current open file. Yeah, this is the file here, would also be passed here. And then we could say we want to look here in our debug. Here's our breakpoint, so we would stop here. Then we would look here. We have a new script called debug with a new configuration called debug with script. And then we would run this. And undefined. Oh, and then I have forgot something somewhere. What did I forget? Ooh, 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 ooh. No idea. Let's throw everything out.
Can you run it again? What was the message?
It said that I used that something in the configuration was broken. Selected text cannot be. I didn't select anything yet. So I have to select something here and then run this here and what's.
Okay. So now cannot read property on. Undefined. Is the debugger is throwing an error on of undefined.
Genuine selected text. Is this right? This is right. Launch debugger sh file name. Yeah, that's right. I think I. Yeah, this is also right. Oh, wow, classic, yeah. Oh, what did I do wrong? Selected text. Punch, yes. I run this. Can that be signed? Yeah, this is. Property of undefined, not even a dependent. Did I type something wrong here?
I guess it's gonna need to run
this year.
Yeah.
It was an error, but it wasn't that. Yes, said.
We're gonna need to run a how to debug the debugger.
Yeah, it's a bit strange right now. I didn't have this problem. Did I write something wrong? It's debug.sh, debug.sh, workspace, root, everything is written right. And the port is right. Did I forget to run the address?
Okay, I guess we can send everyone a message later with instructions to fix the issue after we narrow down to the root cause. The idea is, I think, can you please go back to the app.js?
The idea is that you can select this and or select that, and you can start your hello world function with that event or with that event. And as you can see, it will use the .event/events/ the selected event.json and the selected function.json. Yeah. The selected function name. Yeah. So exactly. The idea is that you could have like hundreds of these things here, and then you would like go, this is broken. Why this is broken? I need this event. You know? And then you would like go in here, run this, and everything would work normally. And you would see it would run normally like it did before. Yeah.
One advantage as well, I see having these comments as comments on the code is that if you have someone else
I got it.
Aha moment.
Yeah, it's not, you can see it like
here. The event. Isn't it the directory?
But, so now it has, you know.
It didn't have read access.
And it's woohoo, and now I do it right. I don't get perfect. It's always wrong folder or wrong permissions. Yeah. Those are the main bugs.
Yeah. Okay, so don't forget to set your file permissions correctly.
Yeah.
For everyone. So I think one of the main advantages of using this approach is that if you have someone else coming into your team and he needs to work with this code, he's not familiar with the code base yet, and he needs to debug an error, if you have instructions, clear instructions as comments like this at the top of your Lambda function handler with all the parameters they can use, the arguments they can use for the debugger, it would be a lot easier for this person to start digging into the function code and actually get into the root source of the error. So this can save a lot of time for other people that might join your team in the future. So I think this is one of the key takeaways for that approach. So it's not only more convenient, but it also makes developers' lives easier in the long run if you are working in a team. Okay, great. We have a few questions. I missed one question, sorry, at the last time we opened. So someone sent a question, how to handle cores issues on that using this fashion. So cores could be, it's related to actually API gateway or whatever you're using as an interface to receive HTTP calls on your Lambda functions. So you need to set up, if you're using API gateway, you need to set up it to allow cores connections. And you're gonna need to address this in your Lambda code as well.
I could show this if you like.
Yeah, please go on.
Okay, so it's not related to debugging in general, but the point is, One part is you have to add cores to your function here.
Yeah.
This is how should I? It's some part here. I think it's even called method properties cores or something. I think it's like here cores, and then it's like this for cores. Or was it? I think it was like this, but this is not, is only the half of the stuff. You have to return the right header. You know, if you write your function, you see you have the status code, you have the body and everything, and I don't know how, what the real name of this is right now, but you can like set headers or response headers or something. I don't know what the real name here is, but here you can set some headers. It could also be that it's like this, and then you could define a header, a course header, like you know from HTTP. Yeah, you have to explicitly set this thing to allow how is it called? I don't remember how courses. Called, but it's like course header and there you have some I don't remember how these things are called. Is something like access control allow something? I can't remember how it's called, but you have to
access control allow origin.
Allow origin. Yes, allow origin.
And you can control if you use an asterisk, it's going to accept connections from any domain, or you can select which domains you want to respond to requests.
Yes, but you have to add this into the response object you return from your Lambda, or else it will be missing. I had this problem rather often. It's like you go to the template, you set your course stuff here right, and then you're still missing the right course parameters. I fixed this by adding the header explicitly to my function response, and then it would work.
Yeah, course can be a thing. But it's more related to the HTTP, whatever you're using to interface AWS Lambda with the public API, with the world. So that's where we need to configure everything. And obviously, you need Lambda to be responding correctly to accept those connections. Another question we received is, can it work dynamically where in if I can change the code and save it automatically starts the debugger running? So I guess the question is, if you're fixing an error, you make a change, you save the file, is it possible to automatically run the debugger as you save the file? You know, okay, that's possible.
I think it's technically possible, but I don't know how. What I know is that you can run different programs every time you save a file, and these programs will be called with some kind of parameters. Mm-hmm. And I think you could write a script that would get the right parameters and start the debugger, but I never done it.
Okay. So if we find out a way to do this, we'll send a note by email to you guys. The other question is, can we debug an AWS serverless application with this debugger, or only serverless functions? So a serverless application is more of a high level way of kind of declaring our serverless AWS Lambda stack, so we can declare multiple functions, interaction with API gateway. It's kind of a wrapper to AWS CloudFormation. Right, Kay, so I don't know if it makes sense to talk about debugging an application, a serverless application.
I think the serverless application is more related to the API gateway, a bunch of services, and the serverless function is related to the Lambda. So I think debugging like this would be applied to serverless functions, and
you might want to kind of test your entire stack. So maybe you want to test the interaction between multiple functions, but that would be if you are debugging a Lambda function that calls other functions in background, we would be able to do this with these debugging style that Kay just outlined.
Yeah.
Okay, last question is, do you use localhost URL for your testing, or do you bind with some DNS server locally for your development? So you're using localhost, right?
I mostly use localhost. I try to write my code that it isn't concerned with the host it's running on. I had some issues in the past with some applications that wouldn't run anymore because it would require the right domain and the right path and the right port and everything. So you would have to update your host's file and recreate everything so it would be exactly like in the cloud. And this was always a pain when working with, especially with new developers. They would come and they would run everything, and then you would like, okay, yeah, we have this big document where we wrote everything down you have to be doing to get your first debugging running. So I try to get all things decoupled as much as possible, so I can use localhost locally and be done with it. I just need the right event and the right function, and it works, and I don't have to recreate everything that is in the cloud.
Yeah, I agree. It would be much easier, especially for new people coming into the project, as you mentioned. So just standardizing as localhost for everyone involved collaborating to a project is the best way to go. Okay, so we've covered all the questions. So I'd like to thank everyone for joining us for this Tech Talk. We will send the presentation and the recording of the session by email to everyone. And stay tuned, we will publicize other Tech Talks we may run in the future. So stay tuned and join us for future sessions as well. So thank you very much. Goodbye. Hey, thank you very, very much for the explanations. Yeah. It was very, very, very helpful to me. And I trust it was very helpful to everyone attending today as well. Would you like to say just the last words?
Yeah. Happy that you had me, and I hope you learned something new about debugging with Visual Studio Code.
Awesome. All right. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Have a great week. Bye-bye.
Bye.